Finally, you can see here the reason that we do go to all this trouble to make and use semiconducting detectors. The first picture is a cobalt 60 spectrum taken with a sodium iodide detector, and the second here is a spectrum taken with a high purity germanium. Notice the resolution of the two peaks in the high purity germanium. What a difference, 30 times difference in resolution can do. Okay, I just saw one of you yawn and say, so what? Look at this. This is why we pay the money. What sodium iodide smears out beyond recognition, high purity germanium resolves into individual peaks. We can go and identify minor constituents in a material that we can only dream of when using scintillators. Germanium detectors come in a variety of shapes and thicknesses of the PN junction and of covering materials. Ultra-low energy germanium detectors have ultra-thin junctions and carbon fiber windows so they can be used in the sub-KeV photon range. And as a hint, bring lots of money if you want one of these. Low energy germanium detectors can have beryllium windows, and the rest use aluminum. Coaxial detectors give a lot of volume, but have a relatively large dead region at the surface, so they're only good for photons 50 keV and above. Well-type detectors are built with an inner well that holds small samples so that you can have almost a 4-pi geometry. Here is the effect of superior resolution of high purity germanium compared to sodium iodide for highly enriched uranium. And the two spectra are superimposed. The high purity germanium in green and the sodium iodide in burnt orange. The burnt orange is obviously inferior. Here's another example showing sodium iodide, high purity germanium, and CAD zinc telluride, another type of semiconducting detector. The resolution of the cadmium zinc telluride is not as good as high purity germanium, but it's still far superior to sodium iodide. I think that by looking at the three spectra here, it's easy to understand that resolution is very useful in complex spectra like uranium and plutonium. A very important feature here is the 186 keV peak from U-235. It is this peak that we use as a quantitative measure of the U-235 in the sample. Also notice that the uranium characteristic X-rays at around 100 keV. We can hypothesize that the sample we measured here is HEU, based on the height of the 186 keV peak to the uranium X-rays. The source material for these three spectra is freshly made HEU. How can we tell that? By the ratio of the 186 line to the uranium X-rays, as we said, but also by what's not here. Above 250 keV, there are none of the peaks of gammas emitted by the ingrowth of radioactive daughters. What do I mean by all this talk about radioactive daughters? Here is the simplified decay scheme for the thorium-232 series. Many of these daughters emit gammas, as we'll see in a minute. This series is also known as the 4N series because if you look carefully, all of the daughters' mass numbers are exactly divisible by 4. We will skip the 4N plus 1 series because we don't need it right now and look at the 4N plus 2 series, or uranium-238. Again, as the daughters grow in, they will emit gammas. And finally, here's the 4N plus 3, or the uranium-235 series. And it is these daughters that we didn't see in our spectrum. If the sample were LEU, we would have a Compton continuum in that area from the 1001 keV peak from U-238, which is actually from the daughters, but who's counting? Since detectors are much more efficient for counting low-energy gammas than high-energy ones, it's very common for us to measure the enrichment of a sample by measuring the relative strength of the 186 keV peak to the Compton continuum above the 186 keV. Now let's look at a spectrum that is not quite so pretty and see where this Compton to 186 line ratio would lead us astray. If we look at our 186 line, we see that in this spectrum it sits on top of a large Compton continuum generated by higher energy photons. The lead 212 gamma is a clue that something is not right. This is the daughter at the bottom of the thorium chain, not the U-235 chain or the U-238 chain. If we zoom out, we now see that there are peaks from the ingrowth daughters above 250 keV. This sample is a mixture of uranium and thorium. The thorium could just be there because both elements were together for some reason, or it could be from U-236 that alpha decays to thorium. The U-236 is from reactor return uranium, that is stuff that's been irradiated before and put back in fuel. These daughters will contaminate the Compton above 186 peak, and it would lead to an erroneous result. In this case, us thinking that the sample had a lower enrichment than it actually has. What could we do? We could take a broad energy spectrum, and then the 238 peaks could be measured directly, and we could ratio the 186 keV peak to the 1001 keV peak, although this is actually not a common thing to do since you have to count for a long time to get good statistics in the 1001 keV peak. Okay, what does LEU spectrum look like? Here you can see the 238 gammas at high energy and how they forced the 235 gammas to ride on their Compton continuum, which makes the Compton 186 line ratio useful to assess enrichment. But also realize that this ratio will change with time as the daughters grow in.